For those people that have joined us today for the first time, this is part of the field research program at Garage, which is dedicated to Soviet philosopher Mikhail Lifshitz, and we are having Ekaterina Degot tonight. She doesn't visit Russia very often. She works in Cologne, so it's a great event for us to have her. Especially that today we have in this talk related to Soviet post-war art. I'm not going to share my own views and comments because we are going to have a discussion after this presentation. So you're going to talk for an hour, right? Yes. Yeah. So we'll have another hour for discussion, comments and questions. So now I would like to give the microphone to Ekaterina. Thank you, Dima. Dima asked me to explain what I do in Cologne myself. So I work as a director at the institution called the Academy of World Arts. It's not an educational institution. This is an interdisciplinary institution that has autumn and spring programs and hosting festival called Pluriversale, a program of different events and film screenings and different discussions. And all this happens as a part of decolonized discourse. So it's all about Cologne, the heart of the Western civilization, which is sometimes invisible and suffers from the lack of interest as compared to Eastern Europe. So we want to, you know, to show a different context in that place in particular. And I'm very happy that I'm working at the West as a former Soviet citizen, so I don't just have to adapt to the existing system there, but I'm also lucky because I can work subversively in that context. So this subversive action is very important for me, and I can embed some Soviet international experience as applied to multiculturalism. So this Soviet experience is quite interesting for me. Maybe you've heard about my curatorial projects focused on those things. So this experience has to be put in a new context. And so this is a source of my thinking, of my observations that I'm going to share with you tonight. So this context is extremely important for me because I think that this is the only possible context to understand the Soviet experience. We have to break away from the dual system of Russia versus the West because this duality is not productive and it's not in line with the current situation and the situation of the past. So this is my personal introduction related to what I'm going to talk tonight. So as you can probably guess, I was hesitating before accepting this invitation to talk about Soviet art. I'm actually quite happy to talk about Soviet art, but today it's quite difficult. And I've seen some comments in the Facebook saying, how can you possibly do this? Why do you want to do it? Because the Soviet is perceived as something being imposed again, something that is coming back again, because censorship censorship is related to the Soviet experience. The aesthetic response and political response are connected to that. Many artists and students can feel it on the practical level, along with curators and writers. So it's really difficult to understand how you can talk about the Soviet art without disgust. So anyway, I think it's very important. So studying this phenomenon, and I mean not just art, but other things related to the Soviet reality. So I'm really scared of today's Russian situation, not because of this embedding obscurantism that I can see in the news, you know, some scary pieces of news that come every day. But along with that, I'm afraid of the reaction towards this. And I mean the feedback that I can see, that I can read, because it, those responses can be even more obscurantism. They all those those comments blame authoritarian power, or they blame ignorant people, these ignorant masses of people that have broken through. So. So all this, you know, bunch of simpletons, lowbrow, are making things their way. And I think that this is not productive at all, because it brings back the worst about the Soviet environment and those things that led to the current climate that we have today. In order to understand things that happen in Russia today, it's very important to take a look at the Brezhnev's time, the late time of the Brezhnev rule, which is reviewed, which is considered a golden period, a social agreement between the power, between the authorities and intelligentsia, relative well-being, and the blossom of arts, including independent art, and peaceful coexistence. So this idea is true to a certain extent, but it doesn't cover certain ideological things that flourished during that time, including neoliberal ideas, very tough ideas that were the precursors of neoliberal reformers of the 90s, the idealization of capitalism in its very tough version that excludes the state of general well-being. All those ideas appeared then in different methodological circles, and nationalistic ideas, on the other hand, because they appeared at that time as well. And I can just refer to the experts that say that the ethnic theory was developed in the research institutions in the Soviet Union. And then they were used in the nationalistic revolutions that took place both in the central area and in the regions. So there are many things that have to be studied, and I mean critical study. So the point that I want to make is that it's very important to have immanent criticism of the Soviet time. But it's not about external criticism. It's not about blaming the Soviet experience as if we don't have those flaws and faults. I think that the Soviet experience continues. Now, lots of things have been removed, but lots of things remained. Some things continue to develop organically. I'm now speaking about the Soviet in general. So the Soviet is quite heterogeneous, and we have to use this immanent criticism and recognize that we are part of it, even though we were born in the post-Soviet time, because you're still living in a social reality that have remained since the Soviet time, because you live in this space. So immanent criticism that includes the criticism of its own reality seems to be more productive here. I also think that it's important to historicize this experience. It's important to differentiate between Lenin's time, Stalin's time, and different periods within Stalin's time, and post-Stalin times that hasn't been studied at all, frankly speaking, because it has always been out of the focus of attention. Some unofficial artists touched upon those things, but it's very difficult to understand what happened during that time in the country. So it's very important to historicize and also to set up the geographical context, even though it was a center of the Second World that no longer exists, of communist countries, but still the center that was somewhere in the outskirts, because historically Russia has always been, you know, a hinterland. And actually, it shares the same identity with India or Japan or Latin America, quite big countries. And these contexts are quite interesting and quite productive that have been valorized now. So when we compare Russia to India or Africa, if you think that this is humiliating, you probably should take a look inside yourself to see whether you have some racist tendencies. So we speak about quite broad context related to European art in very complicated colonial and post-colonial links. So I'm now going to turn to my text that I've just written, and this exhibition has just been opened, and this is the reader for that exhibition. Oh, actually, it's a guide. So this exhibition is called Post-War, 1945 to 1965, the art between the Pacific and the Atlantic, and this is a really global art, not just when they take 90% of the Western art and then 10% of the art from other countries. Actually, like half of this exhibition is taken by unknown artists from different corners of the world that were creating their work during this period of time. For example, you could never think that there were interesting artists in Africa. in between late 40s and 60s. So they couldn't really think about any international career at that time, no matter which country we take, artists from Lebanon or Israel or Africa, or the artists from the Soviet Union. They could never really foresee any international career. So all those works get together in the international context. So it's an English text, and I'm going to translate it from English into Russian. It's quite long. And then I'll add some comments as applied to the article written by Mikhail Lifshitz. It was one of his latest articles, but it's not part of this exhibition. And before I make a summary of this text, I have to say that I analyze certain pieces of art that haven't been selected by me. I would probably have selected different works for this exhibition, but while I was working abroad, I had to do this thing. So, for example, I can write in Russian or do some studies while living in Cologne. And I realized that it was so difficult to get access to some factual materials related to Soviet and Russian art. Dmitry's website has lots of writings by Mikhail Lifshitz, but that's the only resource, and it's a big difference for someone who works in the West. Like, if you begin to Google some Western artists, you get some links to his works or some article in Wikipedia. You can find some articles in English about this or that artist, whereas it's completely impossible to find something about Russian or Soviet art. And I don't know why it happens. I couldn't even get through to the link. So Russian art remains a closed area for any external researchers, even if they know Russian. If they don't know Russian, it's a disaster, because it's much more close as compared to the arts in Latin America or Africa. I don't know what you can do here. I guess maybe this is the primary goal for the new generation of art historians and art critics. So this led to the fact that the selection of Soviet art is quite doubtful. Fortunately, they managed to talk to Zlotnikov before he died, and he got some of his of their works in his gallery. So it's good to have Zlotnikov next to Frank Stella. Maybe something Zlotnikov was dreaming about during his life. As to the section on realism that I was writing my article for, I can say that it still says that realism was a Soviet totalitarian art, and the curator of this exhibition sees it quite interesting, though it's not the only definition. So let's begin. So even though the October Revolution of the 1917 made itself known to the world with the sound of abstract forms, the society recognized itself in figurative images of classical origin. And this following Sticking to realism remained the main visual means up to the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991 or even later. The discussion in the early 30s canonized social realism, even though other artists preferred proletarian realism or ideological realism and some others. And realism marked its difference from the previous dominating tendency in Russian art, futurism, because it was the future that the futurists were talking about has already come. And so the new stage realism, and socialist realism had to distinguish itself with bourgeois realism, but it gravitated towards some other things. And by the 30s, Soviet avant-garde was full of discontent with modernist art that translates the social estrangement into symbolic plane and fragmentation. This was unacceptable, and instead of that, the communist artists were moving towards holistic synthetic form, where that estrangement was not demonstrated, but ignored, with holistic alternative being represented. And the radical left art began those experiments with films, photomontage, photography, but simultaneously there was a trend of promoting political picture that was dominating throughout the Soviet period of time. So this negation of independent autonomous art that seemed to be a convenient bourgeois institute, that post-abstract realism was having destructive rather than descriptive power. Even though it's not always felt. So what is this realism? The realism was described as a totalitarian thing imposed from the top, but on the other hand, it was described as a populist approach. It was described by Clement Greenberg as kitsch in one of his articles. I wanted to add something to these definitions that is not satisfactory as they are. So it's the concept of self-colonization, appropriation of classical arts of the West that took place after the Second World War, when class rhetoric gives place to new cultural rhetoric and new nationalism. And a new idea about realism appeared, but it's not said directly. It was about dual copying of reality on the one hand, and imitating the greatest artist of the past, which was marked as positive. And this is a classical chain of problems, which is true to colonial context. There's a book by Mikhail Tausis about mimesis, which is the center of colonial problematics, when the artists from provincial colonized context do not just depict reality, they got into the trap of imitating the European realism. So they became dependent, and realism is discriminated by such big numbers of imitators. And I wanted to demonstrate this point at the example of Vasily Yakovlev's painting straight after the Second World War, which was called a Great Patriotic War. The party decrees and the public sphere had the rhetoric of class struggle and the nationalist struggle, and so the opposition to the social order is interpreted in cultural and political terms. So new nationalism appeared. The Soviet victory over Nazis achieved thanks to some tactical help by the Orthodox Church was seen as a victory over the Western colonial dominance, and the Hitler's policies in the Eastern Europe was explicitly or sometimes implicitly colonial. The cultural war with the West became very intensive after 1946. When the campaign against idealization of the West led to arrests and death of many people that produced culture and art. And then there was an aggressive campaign in mass media, in the press, that made theoreticians and art critics their victims of Jewish origin primarily. So modernism and avant-gardism was stigmatized as Jewish element. So we shouldn't forget about the treasures from the Dresden Gallery and some other treasures of the Western culture that already made their way to the Russian museums. And Vasily Yakovlev, who was a famous restorer, had access to those great pieces. So this neo-academic tour de force of 1945 shows Marshal Zhukov, who was an architect of the victory over Berlin, that has a triumph not just over the Nazi culture, but also over this virtuosity of European Baroque art, and the artist shows that he not only can do these paintings, but also excel Rubens and other teachers from the classical art. So it's a perversive decolonization that we can hear, that it reverberates in the rhetoric of the Soviet power today. We are trying to liberate ourselves from the West through appropriating its culture, its cultural codes and visual codes in particular. So this perversive decolonization is a process with Russia being an exception from it. So it's very important to remind here that circular painting was in European style was imposed on Russian artists by the Peter the First in the 18th century. So this turnover full of triumph, like Russia was colonized by the West through Peter the First, and this was something that the artists accepted. Of course, there are lots of discussions related to self-colonization and exception of the destiny. This is presented as the victory over the West. At the same time, there is another process taking place. So apart from this anti-international decolonization, there was also the process of colonization of its own marginal areas, the outskirts of the Soviet empire that used to be called republics, Soviet republics, whereas Russia was supranational republic. So it played the role of Europe in relation to those other republics. So the colonization of Russia by Europe cannot be considered without the colonization of national republics by Russia. And at the same time, back in the 40s, there appeared different national workshops, academies, where artists from different regions came and began to work. For example, in Russia, we had figurative painting since the 18th century, whereas in Kyrgyzia, there was nothing like that. And some decorative forms began to be stigmatized as provincial or national, so the universal European language was interpreted as the Russian language during the birth of new nationalism that reverberates until today. Now, speaking about Soviet realist aesthetics, it used to be influenced by the very famous text by Vladimir Lenin, Leo Tolstoy, as a mirror of Russian Revolution. What I'm interested about was that Lenin praised Tolstoy as a genius who created unbelievably striking pictures of life. So the writer was seen as a creator of this pictorial thing. And this text had a very important methodological meaning. So painting and literature come together. They are put on the same level because the artist and the writer had to create vibrant images that you can imagine easily for yourself, and if we look at the painting, we have to see everything, not just the moment that the artist showed, but also the past and the future and all the context associated with this. Of course, this is a very difficult task to accomplish, and as applied to fine art, we can see it in a genre called thematic painting, and I wanted to show you this example, a painting by Fyodor Shurpin, The Morning of Our Motherland. This is a very famous painting, reproduced many times, so it was an author's copy, it was folded, as you can see, and it is now in some provincial museum. So what's important here for me is that this painting was positioned as a thematic painting, never as a Stalin's portrait. Of course, it was not painted with Stalin's posing for it. We put it next to Joseph Albert's paintings in Berlin, and you know, it felt as if it was an abstract piece of art, because it's quite abstract in a way, not just because it shows Stalin or some reality, it shows some future. The morning in the future that opens a new day for us that has to be imagined. So this assumption that we have to imagine the future is the basis for this arts aesthetics, even though we have just Stalin's figure here and some agricultural machines at the background. And of course, it's it did not reflect the reality of the country that was ruined almost totally. But the viewer understands that it's important to project this image in the future, and it's, and he or she has to participate in this painting's creation. So it should be like a leap of faith in order to understand this painting genuinely. So you have to feel it and not criticize. So if you think that the contemporary art is working differently in the West, you're mistaken, because many pieces of contemporary art are based on our readiness to accept this type of art, or our knowledge as to what we should do when we approach such painting. So Soviet paintings had certain requirements for projection. And this is another good example. It's called They Have Seen Stalin. And it's not that we are interested in these children. We have to imagine what they saw with their eyes. They saw Stalin during this rally or demonstration. Something that is beyond this painting is what we have to imagine. Like in the previous painting, vice versa, the painter wanted to show Stalin and not the future, whereas here the artist decides not to portray the great Stalin and just shows the children only. In the Soviet dictionary of aesthetics that was published in the 80s, had an article about Soviet realism as a reflection of life focused on the probable and possible. So if you remember the time of perestroika, the late 80s was a special period because people suddenly found out that the film Kuban's Cossacks was not true to life. And, you know, there were lots of food in that film, but people would lose their consciousness because they were so hungry. So it was part of that culture. That kind of realism, the realism of something projected, of something that is possible, and which is beyond this painting. And this begins to play a very special role, unlike Titian, for example. And this changes our idea about art quality, because we can't apply the same quality criteria that could be applied for the masterpieces of the Renaissance. And speaking about the Renaissance, actually, we know the masterpieces, usually. Like, of course, if you were a tourist and found yourself in a French small town and decided to go to a local history museum, and you saw that there were so many bad paintings during the Renaissance, but we usually focus on masterpieces, and not many people know about some other paintings created at this, in the same period. So the Soviet art,
shows
imperfect reality and imperfect picture,
as if
we have to believe that one day we'll have that special morning. So we have to believe that this painting has a certain perspective of development, as promising development in the future. We can perceive it much deeper than the artist wanted, so we can always complete this picture. And so this imperfection opens possibilities for us. So we can predict the future for this painting.
Что здесь, конечно, некий такой гуманистический подход.
So, you can feel some humanist approach
or some
in this. And so the same is true to the artist. So the artist believes that he can be compared with Velázquez or Rembrandt, those great masters that helped him to develop. And I can confirm this because I was studying at an art school. You had to compare yourself with those great figures. And so the artist could always would always hope that he would reduce the gap between himself and the great classics. And there is some, you know, humbleness in this art. So the viewer can look at this painting in a special way, giving the benefit of the doubt. And interpret the doubts to their benefit. And I have to remind you of Bloch, who wrote, we look at something and what it can become. So if we see the imperfection of the picture, it should generate some compassion and not the disgust. Because we should see the possibility for its development in the future. The theory of socialist realism as epistemological instrument is based on Lenin's theory of reflection that affirmed the correlation between objective reality and cognition in both ways. Not just that the cognition correlates to objective reality. It's not that the painting portrays what we have, but also the reality influences it. So the image as a form of cognition of reality influences the reality.
Прямо существующего в самой повседневности Советского Союза этого времени мы вообще не можем говорить, потому что задача этого реализма.
So the main purpose of the realism is very special, and Slavoj Žižek was right when he saw something implicitly idealistic in that Lenin's theory of reflection. Of course, it's a very idealistic idea of art. When the idea of mirror reflection separates the objective reality and consciousness. Marxism and the issues of language studies written during Stalin's time in the 50s proclaims independence of the superstructure and the base. Like ideology and the economics. And this has never been questioned, either during destalinization in the late 50s or later. And the independence of art was determined at that time. And this was the foundation for the nationalization of culture that we experience today. On the 3rd of on the 5th of March in 1953, Stalin died, and in February 1956 there was the second Congress of the Communist Party, declared de-Stalinization, and so it started this period of socialism with human face and finished with sending Soviet tanks to Prague. In 1957 there was a Congress of artists and speakers encouraged to create works that would be enjoyed by many people, that would enrich a person and make them more dignified or elevate people. This was something unimaginable before. So de-Stalinization was a revisionist movement moving from the Bolshevik Revolution towards capitalism. And we can see some examples in that rhetoric, even though the process was very slow. And the 60s was the period of idealistic idea of art, which we can see in the works of artists such as Popkov. This is a painting by Popkov, construction of Bratska. So this artist belonged to severe art movement. And they referred to both classical art and modernist art. When I was writing some texts on art and when I was working with translators, I realized that classic art cannot be translated, because when I mean classical art, I mean some elevated art, like art of the Renaissance or Greek classical art. So maybe it's just my idea, but in English, classical art means only antique art, or art of antiquity, and I had to use the words like traditional art or the arts of the Renaissance and its followers. It sounded quite awkward, but my point is that the paintings of severe style artists, you know, combined some classical trends and modernist traditions like Brecht theatre. For example, it reminds me of some mise-en-scène in the theatre in Taganka, because we can see these people appear in front of us without any motivation. And I think that this could be quite close to Mikhail Lifshitz, rather than the artist that worked during the 70s. That he wrote about in his article. I discussed this with David, and we had a very detailed discussion, and he told me that he couldn't find any proof for that. But after reading some materials, I realized that probably that connection existed through Nina Dmitrieva. She was a Soviet art historian who was Lifshitz's student. She wrote a lot about artists artists that belong to severe style art movement. And when I was a student, a postgraduate student, I actually didn't know who Lifshitz was during those times. And I guess I would never read his articles, because his articles were published in Soviet Culture magazine, some other ideological newspapers. But how the way I was looking at the classical art of the 19th century was similar to Lifshitz's view of things, his view of Rembrandt's etchings. So this is the type of analysis he made. So I think it's it is quite possible to look at the severe style art movement through Dmitrieva's position and some other artists. So, what does mise-en-scène tell us? I guess it tells us about some Hegelian view of art as truth. Art as truth is manifested not only in this dirty clothes that these people wear, even though in the 60s a lot of things were said, that the artist began to portray the truth of life, for example, a person having a cigarette or some dirty shoes, as if they didn't see that these that kind of mise-en-scène looked quite artificial, quite theatrical, because the artist actually, you know, showed us what he demonstrated. So we can speak about the truth of detail and the truth of a technique, the demonstration of the truth of things. The demonstration that is according to Hegel as a teacher of Lifshitz is the truth of things that is revealing itself. A famous quotation of Hegel that turned into the slogan of Soviet realism when it began to realize that they made a conscious choice. And this happened when people began to work in a closed context, because the situation in the 20s and 30s was quite open to what happened abroad. You know, fascism was quite close, so the Soviet Union had some kind of relations with the neighboring countries, and the artists had some competition with Western modernists. But after the Second World War, the situation changed. It was almost impossible to leave the country, so artists had to come to terms with their life, that they had to stay in this country, and so they focused on conceptual thinking with regard to figurative language. Popkov demonstrates this in his article and in his painting. And Dmitrieva praised artists for their search for the truth.
The
truth of things that is the best projection of people, the best thing about things, and not just something we can see on the surface. And the Soviet criticism used the term generalization a lot.
So
they talked about detailization and generalization that the artist had to lead to. And this concept of generalization is related to public property, because, you know, we are now looking at the pictures that could never be seen as goods for private use.
And
it was very important to have this concept of the general, something that belonged to everyone. And this was very important for the artists. They understood that they had to rise above the reality and gravitate towards generalization. Гили Коржев was a very important artist of the time. I'm going to show you just one work of his. It's there's no connection between Коржев and Лифшиц. I won't be surprised if they hated each other. But this is an artist who had his own attitude to classics, and it was as important for his aesthetic views as for his ethic position. So this was common both for him and Lifshitz. This is the part of triptych communists, where we can see a person that is raising a flag during the revolution of 1905. Then we can see a horseman playing trumpets. And then we see the final element. Why did he show those images? Just to make sure that this former military man could create some art similar to classical art. And we can see when this person was copying some sculpture from the antiquity. So it's a model that has been already simplified, and of course this young fighter would interpret it even more. So this copying was very important for Коржев, like a benchmark for him, that explained why the revolution took place. So the copying is related to world classical art. And it's very important to understand that the classical art was codified differently in the Soviet context, unlike capitalist context. So the classical art was high, elevated art, and this was something accessible only to rich people, because it was very expensive to buy tickets to see theater, play, or other things. And so this high art had this connotation that it was art for rich people. This is something understood by the Westerners, because that's what they think about classical art, classical music in particular, because I've got many friends there. Whereas I have a completely different association about classical music, because classical music is something that you can always hear on the radio, that you're tired of it, and classical music, classical art and the reproductions of the classical art is something you can see at school everywhere, something that is brought to the factory so that the workers could see it. So the classical art is something that represents something for all and everybody. And it's probably not the first time that you hear about this category of universal, something for all. And this really works because it comes to the viewer in the form of multiple copies, because this kind of busts, reproductions, were distributed all over the country, because the art system was not based on creating just one masterpiece. The main system was the system of multiplication and reproduction of books, paintings, sculptures. And so this primordial act of copying something. And this is essential for any participant of this process. But this means that this is the copying of the West. It is assessed highly as a creative gesture, but at the same time it is assessed quite humbly, because any copying is a moral act. And here we can see, can feel colonial depression, a depression of colonial subject that cannot achieve the level of classical art, because they can't go there, or even if they sometimes can go there, if they're famous artists, it would usually happen for a short time. And in the late period of the Soviet years, I received this arts education, and you can't imagine what a big gap was between the art of antiquity or Renaissance, which was considered to be the culmination of art. And there was a huge gap with Russian art. So it was a very European-centric model. And we were taught that that was the highest culmination of the world culture, and we could never see it. It sounded quite sadistic, but I remember this as a student, and I'm sure that the artists that lived in the 60s and 70s were living through this, because the art of the West was the object of cultural appropriation, that, and I mean consumers' appropriation. So what? How could I describe what happened in the 70s? And how that led to the current situation. It's all about conversion and appropriation of art as consumerism, because as a result of the end of the Cold War, lots of Western goods and products came to this country. And then a different kind of appropriation happened. And Mikhail Lifshitz wrote about it in his article. And I'm going to show you some of the pictures that I have here. Mikhail Lifshitz was writing an article for Soviet Culture newspaper, and Dima told me that you were going to focus on this more later. So Lifshitz wrote a review of the exhibition. I'm very curious to know how it all happened, because he was a professor, he was not an art critic, he didn't have to write such articles, but he did that, and I wonder why it happened, whether he was asked to do it, because I'm very curious to find it out. So he wrote a positive review of art, and I can say that many of us began to value Lifshitz due to his critical comments with regards to Western art. And so we could identify and could relate to those critical comments written by Lifshitz. Didn't like three etching by Rembrandt, but in that article that he wrote, he praised young artists shown at the Academy of Arts. And it's interesting to see what he praised them for, because those things had nothing to do with what they did. He sees those young artists as representatives of militant realism, because they oppose the Western modernism, because they blame them, because they imitate their art, they want to process the classical art creatively. And this is Oleg Filachev's self-portrait, because he was one of the leaders of neo-retrospective movement, and many people didn't like them because they were neo-retrospectives, but he liked them, and he said that these were the artists that had the future. So this black and white reproduction of that painting, and it demonstrates the level of despair of the artist that tried to be on the same level as the artists of the past, but he, you can see this sadness in the eyes of young artist who is looking at the painting belonging to the Renaissance in the Netherlands. And he understands that he could never, his work could never be compared with those things. And of course, he is trying to achieve that same level, but he also understands that he will never be able to reach it. So, what kind of benchmarks do we have? Larisa Kirillova. This painting is called Happiness, and this is an almost direct quotation from the works by artists of the Renaissance in the Netherlands. And early Renaissance artists will a benchmark, not Baroque art or Raphael, and I can probably make this vulgar Marxist comment. There is another theoretician that I love, Vladislav Shminsky, and nobody knows him, and he wrote a book in Polish. It's called The Theory of Vision, and I think it gives a very original analysis of world art, both of the world art and contemporary art, from the Marxist perspective. And so he said that the art of early Renaissance, of the first accumulation of capital, began to demonstrate some objects, some products that determine our attitude and our view of the paintings. And the artists that work in Moscow, they have their studios in the central part in Moscow, so they dream about the Western art, but they were also dreaming about some stuff related to the West, like jeans and other goods. And this lifestyle is represented in Tatiana Nazarenko's picture, which gives the portrait of the generation. And Lifshitz is right when he wrote about the artists and what they thought about their role as a Soviet artist, who is part of that neo-colonial tradition. I don't know why there is a lady of Fyodor Rokotov's painting from the 18th century, but we can see her portrait not like Rokotov's painting, but as if it was made by the peasant who were serfs, because there were lots of portraits made by serfs, and I remembered that at some point these became very fashionable among art historians and intelligentsia. So there appeared a whole discourse around primitive portraits, and there's a colonial and the colonial meaning of this world has been slipping away from researchers, whereas primitive term. This the primitive art used to relate to Tahiti or Easter Island. So this term demonstrates the cultural hierarchy with the colonial discourse between European art and the art of Aborigines. So this hierarchy is seen here. And the character, the lady in this portrait is next to the artists and who are trying to understand who they are, what they should do. Maybe they should begin to reproduce some Western works. Another painting by Filachev, and Filachev is mentioned in Lifshitz's article. So today I'm looking at this painting, and I feel some comic element about it. What do we see here? We can see fishermen. They work very slowly, and it's not quite clear whether they are working or not. We don't really see if they are very effective in their work. I don't know how much time it will take them to fix the nets, maybe several months. And I can... And I feel a sort of satire here that is also felt when you watch the film Volga-Volga, which was about glorification of the Soviet system. It was a very positive Soviet comedy about the glory of work and labor. If you take a closer look, you see that those people that work at the collective farms only sang and danced and nothing else. And the person who came to get some certificate, he couldn't get the certificate because everybody was engaged in that. But here we can see a different scene because these people look more like in a state of meditation. And the script for Volga-Volga film was written by Erdman. So I can't really call that unconscious satire. It's just the portrayal of reality where art and culture began to play a very important role. I'd love to show you this painting. You can see Vasily Shukshin with his family by artist Yelena Romanova, and Lifshitz wrote about this painting in his article. And this picture generated a lot of arguments, and because it makes you think. And I support that point of view. I always thought of this work as a kitsch, and I guess there is a reason why you think so, because you know, you can see that little house on the left. And it represents Shukshin as a very Russian writer. He is very popular, and he became very popular after his death. And I guess we could use Clement Greenberg's terms, such as it was a populist painting because it shows you some down-to-earth things. I guess it's reasonably true, but when you speak about kitsch, it means that people's consciousness does not have a right to create things that look similar to professional art, that people's art means creating folk art, like trays and some dolls, like wooden dolls. So this is something we love, and we hate kitsch. Because kitsch is not a real genuine folk art, it's something bad. And this is a colonial argument by nature. And from today's point of view, we shouldn't prescribe what we believe to be authentic. So I think that such hybrid aesthetic phenomena like this painting can tell us a lot. While looking at this painting now, you can't but notice how unhappy Vasily Shukshin is in this idyllic environment. And you can't but compare these subjects that demonstrate themselves with the characters painted by Popkov, the post-Stalin subject that sees himself as a liberated person, and the subject who got immersed in the re-colonization. It happened before perestroika, so we can feel this internal conflict. And if we think that this painting polished the reality and doesn't have any conflict, it's not true. And I think there is a flaw in this painting. So I think that the painting with the flaw seems more interesting to me, because Yelena Romanova, who is considered to be the embodiment of different kitsch paintings, are those painters that want to be famous, and that's why their paintings were without flaws. So I think there is something special about these flaws in pictures. But it is related to a completely different context, both aesthetical and economic context. And art used to come to the viewer through different channels without them asking for it. And I can say that that situation could not be reproduced, could not be possible to be reproduced. I can't say that this was the ideal form of it. I guess this is an interesting alternative view of things that finds its way in contemporary art, which is capitalist art everywhere, which is bourgeois art everywhere. However, there are some moments of triumph. Maybe my students have already heard me saying about it, but I'm going to say it anyway, because nowadays we feel, this post-mortem triumph of the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union produced different models of high art that was deeply respected, like Tarkovsky or Pasternak or Solzhenitsyn. So some of those cultural phenomena became very famous internationally. But not, it's not true about pop culture, because neither singers nor TV series or films could never compete with the cultural products from America or from the West. But what do we have now? The most popular, most famous fashion designer that used to be an owner of a semi-underground company, but he became a main fashion designer. Molentiago House. He is a Russian Georgian from Suchumi. He had to run from Suchumi when he was a child. They immigrated to Germany. And so what is he doing now? Something that Pete Lura did, if you know this fashion designer, but he couldn't make his career. It was back in 1986. So what did he do? People put on different objects that could be called cargo cult. So like wild people appropriated certain things that belong to the Western culture. And so the designer accepts this position of a wild man from the East. His name is Demno Gvasali, and so it's difficult to understand what country he came from. But they can recognize that the clothes he makes were the clothes from the Eastern countries. So using this appropriated West as a weapon in the cultural field. So this is one of the models that sometimes can bring us to Gwen Vasali, but also it can lead to some dark future. So this is the context which has not been thoroughly developed by Mikhail Lifshitz. Mikhail Lifshitz is unaware of his role in this colonial or post-colonial situation. But maybe we could talk about it. So thank you very much.
Еще раз добрый вечер.
Good evening.
Катя, огромное спасибо за безумно интересный
Katya.
Доклад,
It was
который
a very
вызывает,
interesting talk. Of course, there are thousands of questions, I'm sure, thousands of objections. And I wanted just to remind you that this talk is part of the program about Mikhail Lifshitz, and Ekaterina
relied on his article
Following the right way, you can read this article online. So this text was considered his suicide, because you know when you read this text now, you are very impressed. So this is all about future art, like Filachev, Romanova, Nazarenko. You were hiding this article. We haven't read it. No, it's been published online for a long time. It's a difficult article to understand. It's like a slap to the public taste, because he did everything to generate hatred of Soviet intelligentsia. Because at that time, you know, we know what Soviet intelligentsia did, who they believed to be the stars. If you don't know the context, you would this article could seem absurd to you. So Mikhail Lifshitz chose the articles that choose the artists that built on late Quadracento movement, and you know how they reached that goal. It looked like a parody. So Filachev with those fishermen reminds me of Monastirsky's work, because you know his work with a finger, so I have the same association, you know. It's the same time period that it came to a stall when it was really unbearable. You know, to live in this world. So you had to let it go through the filter in the form of Piero della Francesco. So you look at something that happened in the street. You know, you can imagine what it was like in the 70s. Solzhenitsyn and Sakharov were in exile, you know, unofficial art dissident. But you created this prism, and so you look at the world through Piero della Francesca. Well, it's beautiful, but you know that you're not a Piero della Francesca. Yes, and the brows, you know, had a certain shape, like Shukshin had in that painting, as if, you know, it was copied from the Barrel of Christ painting. But anyway, I'm not going to go deeper into it. I want everyone to make comments and ask questions. So this time period has never been revised, has never been analyzed. If you try to find something on the internet, you'll see some magazines in the 1973-1974, even though it's a very interesting phenomenon, and those phenomena that haven't been reflected upon have a trend to return, and that's what we observe in the social space. And now, dear friends, your comments. Hello, my name is Yelena. You touched upon some things when you were talking about Soviet art. You said that the artist had the Western artists as the benchmark. And what about now? I meant, did you mean classical art? Yes. It's a different situation now. I just don't want to go there because, you know, it's going to be, you know, it's the same story. Why do we idolize the West? Because you reproduce the same model, which is the heritage of what we have seen. We are now a part of the West. We are in the outskirts, but still we're part of it. You wear the same clothes, you see the same films, whether you're in Perm or somewhere else. So if you try to look for your own national identity, some Russian identity, this efforts would fail you. It would make sense to see the historical connection between the Soviet Union and the process of colonization. Colonial repression of outskirts. Probably we should have this conversation on a different level rather than, you know, emphasizing it again and again that our artists imitated the West. I have a question. Anatoly Osmolovsky. The concept of colonization assumes that there is some autochthonous culture which is ousted by the colonizers. You mentioned Peter the First. So what did they try to oust? Did Russia have its own culture? And that was the first part of the question.
Ну хорошо, просто я хочу сказать, что контексты колонизованности очень разные и очень сложные.
Colonizing context were different and complex. And it would complicate the discourse. It's not about autochthonous people of Africa that were conquered by the conquerors. I think that self-colonization is a very productive strategy, and self-colonization for example, Russian noble aristocracy wanted to speak French, wanted to identify themselves with the colonizers. The same happened in India and in other countries. I think it's a very productive strategy, and it is usually the nationalism contradicts it, opposes it. And many people say, oh, we should go back to the roots.
Нормального историка нету никаких оснований.
But I don't think that any historian could say that we had autochthonous culture that we want to get back to. But it would be easy, you know, to satisfy that need. This autochthonous reality would be built very fast. It would be like avant-garde.
Стандартным, но вместе с тем не уникальным, да, таким контекстом сложной
колонизации, но который скорость повторяется, but again, it included the colonization of republic. If we don't consider this, then we would have the same position as Russian nationalists. I think the concept of colonization and cultural colonization is questionable. It doesn't really work. If we take a deeper look at the West, what is it? It's a myth.
Запад, может быть, стал существовать,
the West
может быть, последние 20
began
лет,
to
когда,
exist
in the last 20 years
when the countries got together as a European Union.
Германия,
before the creation of the European Union,
there
was no West
войну,
because Germanic people
were
called the Huns.
And,
the Huns, and then the UK was always an alternative to European West. It was not a homogeneous formation. So, if we say that the West colonized the country, then what country benefited from it, and whether we can speak about colonization, whether it's possible to say it was a process of colonization. Like Uccello and other artists created their own painting, does it mean they call colonized Great Britain or France.
So,
why do we say that when Peter the First made people destroy the paintings, or we call this colonization? I think these are very simple questions. Peter the First was the first to make
colonization gesture, but the colony belongs to something. So if we speak about the definition of the colony belongs to a state. So I don't really understand, because colonization is about obeying, but you moving from Soviet art, because we wanted to focus on the Soviet art. And whether we can look at Soviet art without hatred. Well, I think the hatred or disgust would be too powerful. I don't think that Soviet art could generate such emotion. I feel indifferent to it. Maybe it's true for students that were studying it, those students that were made to write their graduation papers feel this disgust.
Добрый вечер. Олег Каторгин меня зовут. Олег Каторгин.
I'm an artist from Prague. About a month ago, Оганян and Radical Realism Group, they are contemporary artists that live in Prague, turned to this to the same topic: how to look at Soviet realism without hatred. I know that Dmitry Gutov visited those events. Could you please comment on that? Well, the idea, I guess, is in line with Lifshitz's article, Following the Right Way. I think it's a failure in Avdii's case, because you just see a repetition of Soviet painting. If they could find a new language for this phenomenon, maybe it would be interesting. But what I saw is not. And I know Тер Оганяна for many years. It just, you know, works as a performance, but not as art.
Кеся Чехров,
thank you for your lecture. It was very interesting to hear about colonial elements. But I heard two models: classical art as the image of the universal, the generalized, and on the other hand, there is appropriation of the Western classics. Being imposed. It's not imposed, it was accepted willingly. But it's very interesting to see this gap. So there's a self-colonization on the one hand and generalization on the other hand. But I didn't get how you linked, how you moved from one point to another. You mentioned that there were no Eastern models in that story. But I would argue with that. There was a Soviet project, world literature monuments, and they had some masterpieces, like Arabic masterpieces or Iranian masterpieces. And you mentioned that it was not only about Europe, but the world. And even Eurocentrism was there still. It was a world phenomenon. I can agree with that. And so self-colonization took place in the 18th century. Then there was a lot of reflections in Hegelian spirit in the early 19th century. And then avant-garde in Soviet Russia was against it, represented by Гончаров and Ларионов. And European heritage was expanded to the level of global heritage. And it was due to this democratic system of culture distribution for the society.
I'm Gleb Nepriyenko. I wanted to make a comment with regards to colonization. Answering Anatoly's questions, of course, if you want to deal with those subtleties, it's important to analyze the political and economic mechanisms, because this was the, well, Peter I was the person who brought a lot of new things in politics and economics, and culture was an addition to that. So maybe it could make it clear. And if we speak about post-Soviet period, I guess Russia was colonized as a new place for the West, because the World Bank gave some advice to the major companies as what they could do here. So we can see this logics of colonization. But my question is related to a different thing. I wanted to ask you about the relations with the ideal. If we split the Soviet period into pre-Stalin and post-Stalin time, you know, there is a very important figure of ignorance with regards to the ideal. And Lenin was talking to Bukharin in the 20s, and he said we didn't know what socialism would be like. And so if we speak about constructive production model, we can see that they didn't know how to organize everything, and photography was an attempt to find out what it was all about, and that's what happened during Stalin's time. There was some response, and that's why this procedure for achieving the ideal was so important during Stalin's time in films, for example. And in pictures, so this figure of ignorance became minimal, and this unawareness of what communism should be like was minimized, and this figure gets back in post-Soviet art, and it was very interesting that you mentioned this flaw, and I guess this was a growing form of unawareness, something that was productive in the 20s, turned into some negative unawareness. And this appeared in many areas as the ideal that could not be reached. And this is what we see in the paintings. An attempt to get closer to the ideal that turns out to be impossible. Well, I don't know what it was like in the 60s, because it was clear that that bright future was a phantasm. I'm not sure that they had this idea about clarity. There was a song about this dreams that were so beautiful but not quite clear. And when we were working with Strugatsky's novel, Monday Begins on Saturday, the character had a chance to find out his future, and he decides not to do it. He refuses from the opportunity to learn his future at the end of the novel, even though he is a scientist working on the happiness, the future happiness of people. And so he thinks that the future should be unclear. This was what happened in the 60s. And,
in post-Soviet
time, those faraway horizons where everybody wanted to aspire towards disappeared. My name is Igor Davidov. Thank you very much. As to socialism, it functioned as a system of symbols, a system of signs. I mean Volga, Brezhnev, and Stalin's socialism. So it was not very different in terms of methodologies. It was not very different from avant-garde practices. So the first question, which is related to self-colonization, I guess genuine colonization started early during Catherine the II. And as to cultural self-colonization, you said you liked it, but does it mean that we need to have Russian Europeans or Russian Americans that, you know, have to lead us to the bright future and become our leaders? And the second question is related to Kitsch. Something which is considered to be folk Russian art was invented in the late 19th century. Faberge eggs and matryoshka, this nested wooden ball. This was a kitsch in itself.
Искусство, если это можно назвать, Голливуд и прочее, это не является антитезой вот этому псевдонародному искусству, да? Это скорее антитеза подлинной культуре, которую как раз, как вы правильно сказали, продвигали в Советском Союзе, заставляли учить, из-за чего многие бунтовали против него, о чем Лифшитз написал в своей статье. Вот, как люди бунтовали, разговор с чертом назывался. И, собственно говоря, здесь вопрос, все-таки может быть, ну, я, конечно, понимаю, там демократизм и снобизм, когда ругают кич те, кто считаются как бы интеллектуалами, при этом сами любящие Тарантино. Да, просто получается, что там Тарантино — это простые и умные, но умные смотрят во второй интенции, а простые в первой, да, и всем это нравится. Вот, и здесь, собственно, вопрос в этом, что это ложная дихотомия между признанием
Recognizing kitsch, invented by Russian noblemen. But I think that our view of what is not democratic enough. And, so it's not democratic, especially if you see it from Germany, like this hierarchy that is generated as to what belongs to folk art, what is to be considered kitsch. Well, as a curator, I can choose anything I want for my exhibition, so I don't have to motivate it that this is a higher art and this is not as high. For example, I wanted to exhibit that kind of marker because I think it's not worse than Joseph Beuys's work. They're just different things. And I think Soviet works of art with flaws tell me more about things rather than traditional modernist art. And as to your first question, I actually forgot what you said about
self-colonization. Тем, что на Западе сейчас, вот на том Западе, на котором я сейчас живу,
it sounded like a provocation in the West where I reside now. I can say that
насильственного мультикультурализма.
You know, there is this forced form of multiculturalism that dominates in the West. You know, you categorize people into as based on what culture they belong to. Like, oh, you're from Russia, you like borscht, but what if I like rucola with shrimp salad? You know, I grew up as a great fan of Dante or Shakespeare, so I have a right to European culture just like any Westerner, even though I speak German with accent, I don't speak Spanish at all. So this is the idea, you know, of people that absorbed European culture during colonization period. So it's not only Englishmen that have right to Shakespeare. Indian people also have this right. And, you know, sometimes the culture is ascribed to people automatically, but my culture is your culture also. I don't want to have my own culture. I want to have a right to universal culture, because culture is a universal phenomenon, belongs to everyone. So this was my provocation, this position of self-colonization. Explains. And this is also the basis of contemporary Russian racism. You know that states, oh, we are Europeans, we are not those dirty Asians. So that's what it means to be a European person. So this is disgusting. This is awful.
Видя небольшого комментария, это абсолютно почти лифшицианская или гегельянская позиция, потому что Гегель говорил, что поразительным образом мне греки гораздо ближе, чем сделавшие что-то 2000 лет назад, чем мои народные песни, которые сочинились на немецком языке недавно. Так что это очень близко к тем сюжетам, которые здесь обычно обсуждаются. У меня такой вопрос. Если ты помнишь, энное количество лет назад, когда я делалась новая экспозиция в Третьяковской галерее, я обсуждала, что там надо показывать, были приглашены, тогда это было принято, видные западные искусствоведы, кураторы, мыслители. Была дискуссия, Екатерина специалист по советским 30-м годам, и одна из женщин, искусствоведка, не помню, с какой стороны, сказала, зачем вы вообще об этом говорите? У вас была иконопись,
авангард,
icon painting, you had avant-garde and romantic conceptualism.
Whatever you have between avant-garde and romantic conceptualism should be thrown away and forgotten. So does this undemocratic position work, especially with regards to the art that you analyzed today? I guess this the current picture of the world appeared due to the curators that showed the artists from Nigeria, but this choice was not exactly right, because I have to say that the Tretiakov Gallery works awfully. They never reply to your letters, they don't really care what you show, even those right paintings that they wanted to get, they couldn't, and so this triumphant Soviet art is represented by Valery Yakovlev, even though it's important to show less known art.
Ну, то есть, напомню еще одну историю. Первая выставка «Москва-Берлин», которая проходила в Берлине Мартина Гропиусбау, там была большая стена так называемого соцреализма, где вперемешку висели Ефанов, действительно кичевая сталинская живопись вместе с Нестеровым, Пластовым, а напротив Уст и Авангард. И вся экспозиция, я там слушал на экскурсии, хотя они были на немецком, но смысл был ясен. Вот здесь соцреализм, который есть кич, и всегда кичем останется, здесь прогрессивное искусство. Ну, то есть, когда Квинслистер показывает африканцев, он все-таки берет там такие вещи, но то, что я его увидел, да, которые, для которых есть механизмы восприятия. Если ты показываешь Кириллову, вот эту Мадонну,
Кириллова,
ну, мне кажется, что просто у людей нет органа зрения, через который можно вообще на это смотреть.
Потому что это как раз совершенно недостаточно изъян. Можно найти такие работы, в которых есть изъяны, и которые можно поставить в контекст.
Ну, то есть только через концепцию изъяна мы можем это ввести и сделать
воспринимаемым.
Все эти вещи тоже требуют какого-то because понимания, они недостаточно отчуждены от своих создателей. Это не отдельное произведение Кириллова, да, я имею в виду, какие-то такие совсем Кириллова, скромные, скажем так, такие скромные советские картины, которые очень связаны с личностью художника. Это не отдельное, это совсем современное. For example, what I did in my exhibition with regards to Pirmiak and Subotin, when I had to exhibit their quotations, their diaries, their texts, the current Western model is still based on the concept of a masterpiece. Даже если организация не коммерческая, мы никуда от этого не деваемся. Эта модель по-прежнему остается внутри нее, сложно показать.
Get away from it, and it's very difficult to exhibit something within this model, even though there are some ways
to penetrate.
And so, you know, you feel that
эта картина Шопена и была на это рассчитана.
But everybody is happy to do selfies. Входила замысел.
Картина, кстати, ему дорого обошлась. Он был молодой парень. Почему он известен только одной работой? Он был молодой парень, когда он написал, получил сталинскую премию. Это стало самой знаменитой картиной конца 40-х, начала 50-х, после чего он спился. И больше уже просто ничего не сделал. У него было... Короче, он за эту картину жизнью расплатился, между прочим.
Got an award, Stalin's prize, but then he, you know, became an alcoholic, and so he died.
Спасибо, Сергей Соловьев. А можно совсем тогда другая опера? Вы обозначили стратегию вот, советского,
стратегию нонконформизма в контексте.
Лена Тупиковая.
Тогда или сейчас?
Тогда.
Did it work during that time? Well,
я в принципе не вижу, честно сказать, большой, чтобы прям разницы.
Don't see any difference.
Были художники, которые там героически несли знамя абстрактного искусства,
that, like Юрий Злотников,
но они скорее были единичными. Вообще-то художники, скажем, там, теоретики искусства,
I guess they treated it more like art theoreticians. They analyzed it more seriously, unlike other artists. But I think they went in the same vein. You know, they existed within the same vein of art that made its choice towards figuration.
Павел Отдельнов.
Thank you very much. My name is Pavel Odelnov.
Как вы видите, как бы вы определили границы такого явления, как соцреализм?
The boundaries of socialism. How would you identify the boundaries of socialism?
Когда оно закончилось или заканчивается?
When did it start? When did it finish? Or maybe it hasn't finished. It has finished because it was a type of art that fit within a certain institutional system of government. Commissions on a big scale that basically will guarantee to every participant. So it was like a system of the Soviet state. So this finished definitely. Even if some artists continue to work in the same way, there is no more socialist realist art.
So
it started in the early 30s, and it shaped after 10 years after the October Revolution, when it became clear that you couldn't have the past, you couldn't have any market support.
That's when socialist realism began to
shape itself.
So you connected with the government commission, right? Yes, because there was no other way. When there's no private market, the artist can exist only, can depend only on the government commission. It could be also like film settings or theater production setting. This was a form of state support for the artist. The government commissioned certain things for different events. So some artists got more support, some less, and there was no other chance for the artists to survive. In the 60s and 70s, more and more artists began to make art that was, you know, lying on a shelf when they just did something for themselves rather than for the government. Well, it happened often, and I guess there was this reflexive point in many artists' life when they had to divide between the commission and the works for themselves. It's true, they didn't want to exhibit some of their art because they created the art for a certain narrow circle of friends. Do you call it socialist realism? No, those works were created outside of that system, at least institutionally speaking. They do not belong to socialism. So it's not a style, it's more like an institutional system. Well, socialism was the name of official Soviet art, the art that developed within Soviet official institutions. And unofficial art was a sort of outsider's art, but it you know, became aware of itself and grew, developed in different directions. What about Larissa Kirillova? Is it her work socialism? Yes. We can describe it through aesthetic categories, and then we can see that there were some opposite things, incompatible really things. For example, Нестеров hated Alexander Герасимов because he thought he was a monster, but surrealists didn't like each other either. Well, I mean, there were lots of aesthetic differences that the artists had, and I'm sure that
we will probably see social support for art, you know, legitimation of military actions. It is sacred from what I
guess some people are already thinking about it. It's not going to be called socialist, but something like this should happen. When there is an ideological shift, then you need a certain aesthetic aura.
Все возвращается, все, что не было, все, что не было пережито по-настоящему, продумано, все возвращается прямо в самых чудовищных формах. Это, кстати, была точка зрения Лифшица по поводу того, что происходит сегодня, вот если брать его методологию, совсем чуть близко к тому, о чем сегодня шла речь, то он это определял фразой «шаг вперед, два назад». То есть такой, есть такое движение вперед, которое есть необходимостью отбросить назад.
Backwards. So that's the essence of his text, if you read them attentively. Are there any other questions to Ekaterina?
I have a question for her.
So can you really look at this art without disgust?
Yes,
you can, and you should.
I think I don't agree with this return back to the Soviet time.
When it is considered to be a return,
to Soviet time. There were certain things that generated the obscurantism and other ideologies.
So it's very important to look at the Soviet in general in order to understand it, because we haven't studied lots of post-war things. We know very little about it,
and
maybe there is some knowledge, but it's so little, and you can't find this information on the internet. Thank you very much, Ekaterina.
Спасибо всем, кто пришел.